Got no questions, but a cue where that 7C is, it makes a little bit more sense. Here today to talk about geometric dimensioning, specifically on two dimensions, and where we have to go with 3D. At the present time, I'm retired from Ohio University. It says Ohio University in a little sheet. Pleased as punch to be retired from Ohio University. And nowadays, I go by the moniker of multi-dimensional management services. Basically, I work for other people, go and give company workshops on a number of different things, geometric dimensioning being one of them. And I don't know about you, but I'm freezing to death, so I'm not taking this coat.
It is chilly.
Yes, the whole building is chilly. So today, we're going to be thinking about table of contents. Yeah, I'm going to go through the abstract that I prepared for this presentation. A standards timeline. I'm not sure how many of you are even aware of the topic. Part B, production communication model. This is something I put together back in the middle 80s to try to explain how our company was doing things based on simultaneous engineering, which was coming out that time. The 115.5 standard, talk a little bit about that. But what I'm really here to do is to introduce you to, if not explain some more about model-based definition, which that's all that it generally refers to as PMI. And I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with this, but this is the way to the future. Kind of why I'm here to talk about this, the standard, the 114.41 standard, and what it entails. A few pictures. And then some GDT applications. Once I get done with this, then we'll go into solid edge and show how to apply the symbology. It's a really rather simple presentation, but the solid edge folks asked me to give this, and so I said, okay, I'll do that. So the abstract, we've been dealing with geometric dimensioning for a long time now, since the 40s, at least in the United States, and generally attributed first idea was a guy named Charles Parker, not Charles, Scotland. Of course, they invented everything in Scotland, and so they invented geometric dimensioning there as well. In the latter part of the 30s, it actually migrated over to the United States in the 40s. As far as I know, Pratt & Whitney in Cincinnati was the first company to use symbology on drawings. In fact, most of the areas of product realization. I think of product realization because I used to teach quality management systems. So I think about the drawing as being a tool to explain things to people downstream. Design, tooling, production, inspection, expand on that a little bit. The 2009 standard and the digital product definition or digital modeling standard talk about how to apply geometric dimensioning in 2D and 3D. That's changing as we speak. Well, Siemens refers to, and anyway, it's really known as model-based definition, MBD. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that stuff and show you how to apply some of it. Relative to the timeline, where we start, I started back in the 40s. The first documentation that I have is basically an Army ordnance D-size drawings that they broke down into 15 pages talking about geometric dimensioning symbology. It's the first document that I know of in the United States to do that. And then because it's a military thing, the Mil Standard 8, those of you familiar with the Mil Standard 8 series, started in 57. And it was revised again, 8A. And then the first United States standard came along in 57. 49 is when the first one, 57. And so we had this parallel thing going on with the military and U.S. standards. I don't know about you, but I grew up with the Chevrolet drafting manual. Takes you back a little ways. Some people may know that document. And everybody used that because it wasn't really a United States standard, was very reliable. Then we had the MIL 8B and C standards. And along about in this time frame through the 50s and 60s, there were also ABC conferences. America, Britain, and Canada got together because we were allies. And during the latter part of the 60s, Australia got involved in that. So this ABCA series. And they were talking about common things between them. This is what developed the standards as we see them today. And then the United States of America standard, Y14.5. Do they know what the first drafting standard was produced in the United States? What do you think the topic was? Sections. Like in 1914, the United States created a standard on how to create sections. It was the very first thing. This is where I got started, latter part of the 70s, using the standard. And then where I worked, when I first started going to work at the place where I really learned most of this stuff, the 82 standard had just come out, and our company had just gotten involved in a lawsuit. And so the company that bought our company, you know how that works, conglomerates, they said, thou shalt use this. Well, I was the guy with the education, and so they said, okay, you're going to teach it. Well, thanks a lot. I'm trying to learn it myself. And so I got trial by fire. Some of you fit in the same category. And then the 94 standard came out, and that was a pretty good one. But the big one, well, yeah, intermediate there, we came out with the 41 standard. So these two standards together are what drive geometric dimensioning in the United States these days. And not only that, but around the world. This particular standard is used more than any other dimensioning standard in our little Earth. Much more than ISO standards ever thought about being. So you take multinational companies like General Motors and Ford and Chrysler, they use this document and they force people around the world to do that. Well, the idea of digital modeling came about in the aircraft industry, and they needed a bigger standard to handle some of the things. When all you have is the digital modeling, you're never going to have a piece of paper. How do I put all the requirements on the drawing? Because the geometry is perfect. And we're out to 14 decimal places or what else. So I can't produce perfect parts. I need some way of telling people what I'm willing to accept. And I need to be able to do that in a 3D and a 2D sense. Those of you who only deal with 3D models, you're not there. And then the 14.9, look at the gestation period, 94 to 2009. I got started in this as a committee member in 95, but I was actually attending meetings since 1990, so I've been doing this a long time. And I'm the guy who does all the figures for this particular standard, all 360 of them or so, and they're getting more. And then we came up with this modification. Now, both of these standards are in review right now. This particular standard, we just had a meeting last week in Dallas where we are reviewing comments, public comments. We didn't have but about 1,400 comments, so it's less than what we had in the last standard. So we are developing a brand new standard. It should be out sometime in 18, at least the timeline that I saw. And at the same time, this 1441 standard is also being modified. And so I have to work with those guys. We work together to try to make sure that we're sharing information. One of the new things about the 41 standard we're going to be adding to the existing standard is surface texture and welding symbols, which is an interesting one because welding symbols is in a different organization other than the American standards. National Standards Institute, which is the governing body, but the American Society for Mechanical Engineers is the one that does all the work and gets all the money. And ANSI takes, how much do you think their cut is? 20% of whatever ASME makes. And if you want to buy these, break out your wallet, because I lost one and some luggage coming back from Costa Rica. $220, including shipping. The first one I bought was $24. So things have changed a little bit. This is the way I envision the world. This is what I put together back in 85, 86. And when I first put it together, there was only arrows down in red. And then concurrent engineering, simultaneous engineering was real hot in early to middle 80s. And so I added the arrows that were now communicating back and forth. And so being able to produce the drawing at the design stage is just the beginning of the story. You're not even close to the end of the story. Those of you who are only creating models, man, you're just doing disservice to everybody downstream who has to verify. Because somebody's got to go through some inspection. And I know that the BA97.2 inspection document is one of the least purchased documents out there, but that tells you how you're supposed to report things. I mean, it's more than just a model. I mean, I've seen some beautiful models. Jesus Christ, the things you can do with solid, and with the modeling tools and enhancements, Solid Edge has really tremendously changed since I started using it probably 20 years ago, something like that. I mean, it's a wonderful tool. Oh, jeez. Did you guys see the pictures last night of the modeling thing? The motorbike, the one that was one, I think the one that had the two beds in the room was what people told me took more effort than the motorbike. But no, man, beautiful stuff. Sells well. Doesn't make a damn thing. But it sells the product really well because it's beautiful images. Didn't used to be able to do that. But the drawing, look all the pricing I used to get most of, I was in refinement most of the time. Everybody would look at all that geometric dimensioning on the drawing and say, oh gosh, this must be expensive, and jack the price up. Nothing could be further than the proof, further from the truth. It's geometric dimensioning saves you money. It doesn't cost you money. It costs you money initially to learn it. And there's a hell of a lot of things to learn, I'll give you that. But still, that's not all of it by any stretch. Planning, routing, all these people have to look at the drawing and make a decision as to where the product is going to flow through this shop. And it's based on tolerances, based on geometric dimensioning, based on what the machines can do. And then the poor people on the outside here, sales are always selling something you can't make. Purchasing is always buying junk you can't use. You know how all that works. And then we've got our customers and the people who make things, vendors for us on the outside. As soon as you contract with a vendor, they're now your employee. They need to know all the symbology and stuff that you're supposed to know. You notice I said supposed to know. So it's a big picture, a huge picture, more than just what a beautiful model would do. So we're dealing with this thing. This thing in here has pictures out the wazoo. Most of it, I looked at 1993 neon hood. I finally added that one. All these pictures of all these different ways of applying things, it's an exhausting list. You can't, my best time is a 4-day workshop. I can cover justice in 4 days. 3-day is just constraining. And 2-day, how do you do that? It's a big topic. It has pictures in it like this. The very first picture on the cover is the right side view of this one. In the next release of the standard, I created a 3D version of this. It's really neat. Wait till you see the new version. It's got some really neat pictures. So all the symbology and the way it's supposed to be applied and lots of good variety. In the 94 standard, we knew that the 3D modeling world was upon us. And so we have, I think, 5 different figures in the standard at the current showing you how to do it. And we have learned since then, so this is kind of an old figure. But the one up at the top is what you would say on the 2D orthographic view. One down at the bottom is what you might see appearing in your 3D model. And we're going to try to see if Solid Edge can do it. Solid Edge can do a little bit of it, but it can't do that. Then there were things that came about in the 41 world that forced the 2D world to take notice. One of them is the circle U symbol, which is the unequally disposed profile symbol. You guys use that? It's a wonderful symbol. rather than using the phantom lines to show which direction the tolerance goes away from the true profile, anything positive to the right of the circle U symbol is the amount of the tolerance zone outside the material. A godsend. So we've got some figures in there showing that. But then that leads us to the idea that I really want to get to today is that your 2D drawings days are numbered. Probably within most of our lifetimes, you're going to see 2D drawings just going away. Now, it generally requires a vertical integration to make this happen well. Horizontal integration becomes a nightmare. If you're sitting out there making 200, 105 of something a year, it's going to be tough to get your vendors to use the same database that have the same CAD system. But the Boeings of the world and the McDonald's and all the aircraft companies that really started this, I had some figures in here, some pictures of a wing spar for a 757. I mean, it's longer than this room. And you're going to collapse that thing onto a D-sized sheet of paper and be able to see any detail? It doesn't make any sense. So these guys have quit creating 2D orthographic views probably 15 years ago, if not longer than that. That world for the aircraft industry is gone. And the auto industry has pretty much dropped it as well because they're fairly vertically integrated and they can force the suppliers to have the same CAD systems they have. It's really a change that is going to affect all of us. Last fall, about this time, I reviewed a new standard, Y1447, which is talking about model-based definition schema. You know, how do the programmers create the scheme for how all this stuff is supposed to work? All the programmers of the world. And that led us to the idea we have companies now that are model-based enterprises. There is no 2D drawing. So the aircraft industries have jumped that big ditch and they're not going back. 2D drawings are pretty much out the window for lots of companies and you need to start realizing that. The idea is it needs to be human readable and machine readable at the same time, which is changing a lot of the things we do. It describes form, function to convey PMI, which includes 3D geometry and associated annotations. We're good at that. Solid Edge is pretty good at that part of it. Geometric dimensioning and tolerancing. Solid Edge is not good at that. It is good at that in the 2D world, and there's only about four symbols that aren't the right size relative to United States standards, and there are none of the symbols the right size if you're ISO. I've got a comparison of that coming up. And methods to make computation that are machine readable. Now that we're dealing with STEP, nobody seems to like IGES. As a matter of fact, we just disbanded the IGES standard. It was number 26, Y1426. And that's where they got started. And they have like about a 700-page document. And the people who are controlling IGES are all getting older and they don't have the energy to go back and revamp it and make it viable anymore. So STEP is taking over and all the STEP protocols are taking over. The one that I haven't figured out yet is geometric dimensioning. I know one of the guys that's a honcho in that group and they're having a hell of a time translating geometric dimensioning from one CAD system to another. It isn't there yet. I stole this off the web. When I got on the website, I was looking for all kinds of information. What's out there now? And I found some Solid Edge sponsored sites that showed just about the worst geometric dimensioning you have ever seen. Sponsored website. Embarrassing. Embarrassing to me. So now we jump to the 3D world, and this thing has all kinds of criteria, data set requirements, common requirements for models and drawing graphic sheets. But the 2D stuff that you may get is called a drawing graphic sheet. Notes and special notations, the model values and dimensions. The idea is that I was talking to Ricky, you know, the drafting guy, and he says, oh, what's wrong with it? He knows what's wrong with it. He just Well, the first thing you have to have is management data. Where do you put management data? Where do you put the part number? Where do you put the material? Where do you put any sort of information, the revision levels, all that kind of stuff? Well, that's supposed to be out in front of the model on an annotation plane that does not rotate. Solid edge can't do that. Now, maybe with my kicking and your kicking, it will get that. The interesting part about it is the NX model has driven a lot of this stuff. Leah Irwin, who was a Siemens employee, was one of the movers and shakers of this whole idea of model-based definition. And NX does a fine job of doing it, probably the best job of any software on the market, including CATIA, because they were there at the doorstep creating all of it. I remember when we were forming that group, we sent out, I'm on the main committee too, that oversees all the other committees, so we sent out invites to all the CAD companies around the world, and NX showed up. And that was the only place that showed up. That's the good news. The bad news is none of us made it down to the solid edge because they're two entirely different products. At least that's what I've been told. And so you get into a messy situation where I have annotation potentially on top of other annotation. This is one thing solid edge does well. We can easily turn off, you know, within the PMI tree, you can easily turn on and turn off different pieces that you want to be able to see or not see. But sometimes when you have all the information on the model at the same time, it gets to be a bit messy. And you need to be able to rotate that model around, and some of those things need to be able to go away. Unlike the datum symbols. Solid Edge hasn't quite figured out how to do that. The datum symbols on surfaces that don't appear, they're not visible, you can still see the little suction cup, the little plumber's helper on the bottom of the datum symbol. And so this is one of the examples. There's the idea of PMI usually does not include dimensions, just linear dimensions. If you want to know that information, you go to the model and you query the model. So querying the model gives you the idea that things have to be associated. So any supplementary lines, like a straightness application, well, straightness is a view sensitive or view dependent control. Well, view dependent control doesn't make any sense in a 3D model. So how do I tell you where the straight line elements are going to be taken? So there's a huge category of supplemental information. That information needs to highlight when you select the feature control frame for straightness. When you select the line element, the supplemental geometry, the feature control frame related to that needs to highlight. So we have this association business. Solid Edge does some of that really well. We need to be able to take that drawing and create a 2D drawing, which again is a graphic sheet. Graphic sheet doesn't have to be orthographic, it can be just an axonometric view. But in axonometric views, we lose the ability to highlight. You know, that associativity goes away. So we're still kind of stuck in axonometric views of saved views or graphic sheets, and that you still have to put points where things start and stop. It's a bit ugly on occasion. This is the axonometric view. Now normally, this profile call out here between J and T, you wouldn't have to put where J and T are, because as soon as you highlighted that, this entire surface all the way around here should highlight. That way you don't need to have a whole bunch of arrows pointing at different surfaces. So coplanarity for profile, I haven't figured out how to do this yet in Solid Edge. Oh man, I'm really hoping some of you know how to do some of the things I don't know how to do. Because I'm here to learn as much as to tell. Anyway, we have all different kinds of things. When I apply coplanarity or profile to two or more surfaces in the same plane or in offset planes, all those surfaces must highlight when you select the feature control frame. I think some of that is there because I just came out of the presentation that Ricky was giving. And I think there's some stuff in there that I didn't know that came in the SD9 that's beyond me. So in the world of, it's slightly different once you get into the 3D. Once you get into 3D, there is no text box, but you do have a call-out box, so we can still use some of it. So basically, the big one is the feature control frame. And this is the part that requires some intelligence to be able to use. Back when they were asking me to do this, I was saying, fine, I hope management has the same goal that I have of building an intelligence like NX does, like SolidWorks does. I mean, your major competitor does it. Seems like you should be able to as well. The datum frame that's showing the old symbology. I mean, we haven't done that since 82 version, where you have a rectangle with two dashes on either side. The datum targets need some work. If you tried to play, I was playing with it. I'm new to synchronous as well, but I think I'm going to switch now that I've seen some of the presentation, because you know you get that flexibility you don't have with ordered. But I'm an ordered kind of guy. I learned it when there wasn't any synchronous to talk about. Man, I tried to apply some targets, and with some interesting results. And call-out. I had to change this presentation because the call-out is a note that you can attach to a feature control frame such that it can, when you move the feature control frame around, the note moves as well. Otherwise, you've got two disorganized pieces of information. So the feature control frame starts off with their little ribbon, and most of the meat is right there in the properties. And this is where you populate the feature control frame. This is where all the mistakes are going to happen. At the present time, we have 14 geometric controls through here. If the standard goes out the way it was right now, we're going to lose two of them. The idea of concentricity and symmetry are out. You can do the same thing, position regardless of feature size. The only reason we left them in the 2009 standard is because ISO still uses them. But ISO uses position in ways that we don't want to. Now, you all realize that you hit the preview button, and when you type in stuff or you select particular entities, you get a little box to the right of this that shows you what can apply. Now, I've got to admit, this is more robust than some of the systems I've seen because it gives you an option of having four different lines and composites. What I wish there was one more little box at the bottom that wasn't boxed, so I could add each element in different words underneath, but we can't do that right now. We have all the supporting cast in here, and all the stuff that isn't in this list is under the ST symbol. So for statistical tolerancing, the datum frame also comes in with the this one. Oh, it's supposed to be a text and leader in there. Anyway, you can mess with the text and leader to show it or not show it. You guys are ultimately familiar with all this stuff in the datum frame. And this part works fairly well. If you get it to double letters, and the box actually increases in width a little bit to allow double letters to occur. But most parts don't go up into double datums. The datum target symbol itself, three different ways of applying that, either a point line or an area. And we have a couple of options right now. The X is indicated, so X marks the spot. If you're going to use an area of contact, just to the right of that, it shows your circular area. But in the automotive industry, targets are everything. In the sheet metal, there are no datums that are regular surfaces, it's all targets. And I've never seen a round target. I worked in the auto industry over the summers. I used to teach for a living. I had a real paying job. Well, yeah, they paid me money. It was an easy job. I love teaching university. It's so easy. Well, other than the funding part and all the publisher Perry syndrome, pops you guys from. Anyway, native targets are wonderful. I've never seen a rounded or a square one, all rectangular shaped of some sort. And solid edge only allows you to identify square or round native targets. And then the sizes and the symbols and all that stuff. So inside of there, you get the ability to apply stuff. And some of this, you know, solid edge, sometimes they give you three different ways of doing the same thing. Well, this is the same kind of information. There's different ways of getting that information in there. And then the call out. It's a new release. Use a call out. Oops. Use a call out without the leader and allows you to attach it to a feature to the bottom of the feature control frame. The part that I'm not enamored about is it lets you do anything. It lets you put anything in here. And as soon as you let people do anything, what are they going to do? Anything. Without education, we're all dangerous. So I went through and I said, okay, let's think about some feature control frames that should be available. Well, can I do all these things? So I went to the standard, just kind of glibly, and said, can you do the form controls? Well, you'll never see an example in the 14.5 where that tolerance box extends that far. Primarily because I draw each one of them by hand. Every arrow, every letter, every line in all these figures in this document was put in one at a time. Now granted, I have a templates area, but even the flatness symbol is more like an ISO symbol. And the straightness applications, we finally, at my coaxing, got rid of the idea and now we can use maximum material condition of flatness when applied to a size feature. We always could do that with straightness, which is our example down here, but now we've divided it up, so straightness is only for cylindrical features, flatness is for prismatic features. And then the two lone wolves in the group that don't get a whole lot of use, circularity and cylindricity, never use datums. Everything on the left side never uses a datum. Then we get to the orientation controls, and you put in the word each element using a callout without a leader, and you can attach it. So I'm using parallelism, perpendicularity, and angularity. And the perpendicularity symbol is not quite the right size, but it's pretty close. Closer than some. Then you get into the profiles, and the wonderful world of profile allows you to do all kinds of interesting things. Between particular points, tell me that the tolerance zone is one direction or another. Something I didn't put up here is a non-uniform tolerance zone, which usually requires the drawing to tell you what the extents of the tolerance zones are. But we have all different kinds of tolerance zones, basically any kind of tolerance zone you can think about. We can create with the system. And then the runouts are fairly simple. Always require a datum. Most often what's in 2009 is called a multiple datum, where you've got two surfaces that are controlling the primary degrees of freedom. Then you get into the position. Position is just the biggest, nastiest group of the bunch. And there's lots of different examples in there. You can apply it to the maximum material condition regardless of feature size. I put in a least material condition, put in an ST symbol in there if you've got depths to do that. And I mean, I teach classes on statistical tolerancing and tolerance analysis. And there we need the ST symbol. Is anybody familiar with what to the right of the C? The new symbol in 2009, the little triangle.
Projected tolerance zone.
No, that's the translation. The projected tolerance zone is this one in here. Translation modifier allows that datum to move. There's other ways of doing that, but this one came along because somebody wanted to slap somebody and didn't want it to be left alone. The projected tolerance zone is when you want the tolerance zone to go above the surface rather than in the material. And then the idea of composite, I mean, you can have more than one line composite. It's rare you're going to have four. In the standard, I think we have examples of three. And then the ugly stepchildren in the group, concentricity and symmetry, those are, I think there's use for concentricity, but you can primarily do the same thing with profile and position, use a combination of those which is coming up. And then can I combine different controls? Real common to have to locate a particular feature and then orient it with a finer degree. And then the idea of stacking up tolerances, this came out of the standard. This is one of the examples of the 14.5 standard, where you locate the surface with profile, you further refine it with parallelism, and then you give what you really want the surface to be with the flatness control. How about this one? You seen this one? This is the one that scares the hell out of everybody. Customized datum reference frames. It's one of those things that when you need it, you really need it. But most people have a hell of a time figuring out what degrees of freedom are, let alone which particular degrees of freedom I want a particular feature to restrain. But this one allows you to say, you know, A usually controls 3 degrees of freedom, 1 linear and 2 rotational, but you may not want it to do that. You may want it to only control certain degrees of freedom and have other features control other degrees of freedom, which is a huge change to some people. Not that you're ever going to use it, but boy, it's handy. This is a real common one where you have some sort of amoeba shape that you wish you could create a virtual condition for, including orientation controls. And so you can't get a virtual condition out of the profile just by itself. And so you put something on there that allows the virtual condition to exist. And that's modifying the profile with the position control. And then a couple of different datums. Usually you want to qualify your datums. So flatness, you know, before I'm going to use that surface as a datum feature, I want to make sure it's good enough. Because if I don't do this, I can't inspect the part. How do you inspect parts unless you know what is required? And so I look at the feature control spring, and these are all millimeter, 0.4 millimeter is the flatness requirement. That means I must have a measurement equipment that's at least 10 times as accurate as that, if not more. So you have to have these things to fill out the rest of the story. You have to have this to be able to inspect the parts. You have to have this stuff to be able to do any dimensional analysis that you're going to do. If you don't, you just can't do it. And if you don't measure, you don't know. I was in Scotland over the summer in Glasgow, and there's a statue of Kelvin, Lord Kelvin. His name is actually William Thompson, I think. But he went by the moniker Lord Kelvin, the guy who came up with the Kelvin scale. He was the guy that says if you don't, well, it's a real long thing, but he says if you don't measure, you don't know. And I don't want to buy products from you if you don't know what you're making. And if you don't measure, you don't have the basis for which to derive your measurement equipment, you can't measure things. So all this stuff is essential to me. Of course, I live in that world too. I don't live in that world where Bob down the street makes parts and Bob says they're okay and I believe Bob. No. Doesn't work that way. First article inspection is a detailed inspection that you do not make any more parts until you do the first article inspection, which requires all this junk to be on. The people who are on these committees are not the small companies. They're the Boeings and the Caterpillars and the Goodyears of the, you know, large corporations. If they don't do this, they lose. I mean, they're stuck. They have to do it. This is the last slide in the presentation other than my name. Anybody familiar with ISO 7083 standard? Look at the symbols. None of them are the same. So in preparation for this, I noticed that you can go with ISO and an ANSI or ASME or an ISO. So got my feature control frame up there, right? All the symbols are different. So I go from ANSI to ISO switch. What happens? Nothing. So immediately, Ricky is going to hear from me that none of the symbology is correct. I mean, there should be something that changes. Look at the runouts. They're not the same. Different angles, not filled in. All the symbols are smaller. Every one of the symbols is slightly different. But yet when I hit the magic switch, nothing happens. Now the good news is that Solid Edge, in my experience, has the best symbols in the group. I've never seen another CAD system that does a better job of symbology than, at least US symbols, than Solid Edge. AutoCAD sucks. Can we get an amen on that? All the drawings that I create are AutoCAD drawings, but every one of them has been individually constructed because AutoCAD symbology is just about as wrong as you can get. It's closer to ISO than to ANSI, and there is no switch. And sorry, SOLIDWORKS folks, I've used SOLIDWORKS, I don't particularly like it, but I know how to use it, I've taken classes and all that stuff. All their stuff is ISO. Why? Because they're owned by a French company that owns Dassault, owns both CATIA and Solid Edge, or SOLIDWORKS. And you talk about a bad one, DraftSight. Has anybody looked at the symbols in DraftSight? I didn't think it could get any worse than AutoCAD. They can. So that's me. I live in Liberty, Missouri, which is just right on the northeast corner of Kansas City. Wonderful place to live. Where I used to live is where I wish I still lived. So, the simplest thing in the world, a piece of tubing. Have you ever seen anybody draw a piece of tubing like this? If you don't, you're missing something. So how did I get that stuff in here? First of all, if I don't put this relationship in there, how close do those tubes, outer and inner diameter, have to be? I don't know. So if you don't put that thing in there, they could be off as much as they could possibly be, and you would have to buy them. So the symmetric diameter is no big deal. That's the only way you're going to get a diameter or something. Otherwise, you have to cheat and go and throw one in there. And I can always tell if there's an extra space. Yeah, I'm an anal instructor of many, many years. So you know what you do. You look for all those nuances. So we go up here and we grab this little monster here, and it says, okay, the first letter in here is A. Is that good enough? What letters can you not use? Only three. For datum letters. You've been nodding your head a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Obviously.
I. It's a history lesson. O and
Z.
Q. Remember the history lesson, blowback errors, all that stuff. You lose a little tick mark on the key. Letters are different now, but still, you don't have to start with A. You can use any letter you want, just as long as you use the letters properly. So, I don't know, you want to change that something? But if I select that over here, strangely enough, that's acceptable. But if I have a rectangular part, and I did that, that would mean that bottom surface. But I don't want it to be the bottom surface. I want it to be the diameter. So I'm going to grab that thing and scoot it over where it lines up with the extension line. May have to blow it up a little bit to get it to line up. That means that size feature is the datum. Now that I have a datum, solid data will let you use the datum without establishing it first. SolidWorks won't let you do that. So now I go up to the feature control frame and I say, okay, let me go look at the preview. I like the preview bar. And I say, I'm going to start off with the position control. And that's just the control. Then we need to put a little divider, the way Solid Edge does it, put little dividers and things. They don't put them in automatically, you have to put them in yourself. Most of the time, position is going to be a cylindrical tolerance zone of some size. The beauty of position, you can calculate what the size is based on the fit between the mating conditions. There is no such thing as the 57% rule. It's a myth. Don't believe it. Anybody tells you that. So put in something, 0.4, what I have been using. Most of the time it's going to be applied in the maximum mature condition, not all the time, but lots of times. And in this particular case, I only have one datum. So type in the datum. You don't need to give a beginning or an ending divider. And so now I have it. And attach it to that thing. This thing will allow you to attach it up, down, side. Now you'll notice in the standard, everything is justified. If the leader is on the left, it's left justified. If the leader is on the right, it's right justified. That's me. You don't have to do it that way. But that's a simple control for them. You want to do the same thing on the model? How would you do the same thing on the model? Well, it's not quite as easy. So is outside the data feature? Okay. So we can go to the PMI stuff. We give them a little datum symbol. Then A. That doesn't look quite right. We have the ability to lock planes. Lock that plane. There's another plane, so I may have to put this thing back on to be able to lock a plane. So now when I apply that symbol, yee-haw, that's supposed to be there. I tried to do this with my students and they got so frustrated. So I want to go back to, let's put a circularity. About that dot, it's not on the surface. It's only relative to that locked plane. There are many things that can get better with this particular version. And I can tack that thing on the bottom. As soon as you change the scale, you lose connection. I mean, I want it to work really well. It doesn't necessarily at this stage. And getting all this stuff translated over into the graph, if you want to do that, doesn't necessarily work all that well. This is a fairly standard thing where you want to be able to get perpendicularities, building up the structure, building up the datum reference frame. A establishes 3 degrees of freedom or 6 different direction of movement. B restricts 2 more degrees of freedom. And the last one restricts the last degree of freedom of movement. Now I have a datum reference frame, a complete datum reference frame, for which I can apply the symbology. But the one I really want to look at before we get out of time, how do I get rid of it? F5. F5? Mm-hmm. How do you get all that junk in there? Yeah, I'm so tired of seeing this screen. How do I get all that stuff in there? How do I get that? I'm going to go back to my feature control frame. This time I'm going to start off with profile of a surface, which is much more used than profile of a line. Put some sort of a tolerance in there. How much of that do you want to go above that wiggly surface? And how much of it do you want it to go below? So if you want that, you're going to search for that symbol. Select it, tell it you're going to select it, and it'll plop it right into position. Whatever you put to the right of that is going to be the amount above. It could be zero. I want it to all be inside. Or NASCAR, the way they think about templates, anybody got into body making cars and stuff, use template from front to back and side to side. When you put that template down on top of the car, the tolerance only goes in one direction. So you're forced to figure out some way of telling you where the tolerance is going to go. Maybe you want it all outside. Relative to, again, a datum reference frame. In this example, I only use 2 datums because of the way I'm going from X to Y. Datum targets. Life into themselves. So let's try. See, it's still there. I like that part. When I close down, bring up a brand new, different drawing, it's still there. This, the last one I put in there is the one that's still there. So point to some part of that surface, then come up and use your call out button here. Make sure the call-out doesn't have leaders attached to it. This is already pre-assigned. And just attach it. Now when you select this, move it around with between X and Y. This is a between symbol. Travels along with the symbology. Targets by themselves are kind of interesting. So how do you want to do that? X marks the spot in this particular case. You put their point on there. And somebody didn't look at the latest revision of the standard because it still puts a gap. I took that gap out of there. When you control the figures, you can kind of do whatever you want. Good, bad, or anything. I also changed the size of this balloon, which hasn't, that symbol, which hasn't changed. Also change the letter height inside the symbol, and that hasn't changed in this version of the standard. So the balloon size is 3.5 times the letter height and diameter. All the letters inside are 80% of the height of the letters on the outside. The one that you really get into some interesting things is when you get into diameters, and you're going to set the particular diameter. This becomes supplemental geometry in the 3D world. And I haven't had any luck at all with targets in the 3D. Every figure that I have seen projected while I've been here, nobody's using draft and castings and forgings and plastic molded parts. Draft is the world that you live in. And putting draft, putting points on drafted surfaces is not necessarily an easy thing to do, because you have to go in there, either in the model, which I hate, draw in the view kind of stuff, or put something on the model as a little something that I can address to put an X on. That X does not lay on the surface. It's, again, oriented to whatever plane that you use to fly the symbology. And target areas have become, I've not figured out how to get target areas on drafted surfaces. There's a lot of things I don't know yet how to do. I'm learning as I go. And I'm hoping I don't know everything. But I'm pretty sure there's some things that I'm going to be learning. Anyway, that's basically what I have today to show you, just to try to scare you a little bit from geometric dimension. Hope you enjoyed it.